Mariner Books and Harper Audio present Inventology, How We Dream Up Things That Change the World, by Pagan Kennedy. Read by Jonathan Todd Ross. To my grandfather, Stephen Patrick Burke, inventor. Introduction. In 2012, The New York Times Magazine hired me to write the weekly Who Made That column, and so I began hunting down the people behind such inventions as sliced bread, the 3D printer, and lipstick. Week after week, I discovered that ideas pop up wherever they please, and inventors come from every corner of life. A test pilot created aviator sunglasses. A frustrated father devised the sippy cup to foil his own toddler. And experiments in a kitchen in Queens, New York, led to the Xerox machine. Why did these people hit on solutions that everyone else had missed? That question became a thread that I followed to an even bigger one. Is there a formula for invention? And if so, can anyone learn it? So when I reached out to creative people for my column, I asked them about the process that had led them to conceive their bold ideas. One of the first people I queried, Jake Stapp, taught me that sometimes we discover the power of our imagination only when we feel desperate. In the late 1960s, Stapp worked as a coach at two Wisconsin tennis camps. And during those long days of lessons, he spent hours stooped over, retrieving hundreds of balls. His back ached and he urgently needed to invent his way out of this drudgery. Stapp placed a tennis ball on the passenger seat of his car, where it rolled around for weeks, a reminder that he needed to think about the problem. As he drove, he performed mental experiments. He built an imaginary tennis court in his mind's eye and pictured what it would be like to wear an arm extender that would let him reach the ground without bending over. But he realized the mechanical hand would pick up only one ball at a time. That was no good. Finally, during one of his meditations, Stapp reached over and pinched the tennis ball on the seat next to him. When the rubber yielded under his fingertips, he had a new idea. The ball could squeeze through metal bars, taking a one-way trip into a wire bin. Stapp rigged up a basket with a handle and metal bars across its bottom so he could perform real-life experiments. I fooled around with the bars to find the right distance, so that the balls would pop into the basket and stay there, he told me. He called his invention a ball hopper. The next summer at tennis camp, everyone wanted to use them, recalled his daughter Sue Cust. It was a mad dash for the ball hoppers. She observed that when people saw how the ball hopper worked and how simple it was, they would always say, "I could have thought of that." His concept might have seemed obvious, and yet it wasn't. Rubber balls became standard tennis equipment in the 1870s, so by all rights, a Victorian gentleman should have used a wire basket to wrangle his tennis balls. Instead, for nearly a century, tennis players chased down the rubber balls without ever seeing Stapp's solution. That's the mystery that surrounds some inventions. They seem easy in hindsight. And yet, the most elegantly simple breakthroughs can hide from us for decades. So what blocks us from grasping an idea? And how can we find the obvious ideas that are hiding from us right now? To answer those questions, we must study many inventions and look for patterns. For instance, if you delve into the history of cancer cures, squirt guns, and smoke detectors, you'll find startling similarities in the way that they came into existence. So if we can observe the techniques that have led lots of inventors to success, we might extrapolate what methods work best. Invention versus innovation. People tend to use the words invention and innovation interchangeably, which causes confusion. And so before we proceed any further, we should come up with working definitions for both. Art Fry, the originator of the Post-it note, developed his own way of distinguishing invention from innovation, and his definitions are so illuminating that I will borrow them and use them throughout this book. Invention, according to Fry, is what happens when you translate a thought into a thing. More specifically, Fry points out that an invention usually involves creating a prototype that lets you test your concept and demonstrate that it works. Once you've created that model, the creation becomes an invention, according to Fry. The process may require dreaming, drawing, observation, idea generation, discovery, tinkering, and engineering. But it should end with the proof. Innovation is what happens afterward. It is the act of working through all of the obstacles and problems in the path of turning a creative idea into a business, according to Fry. Indeed, the term innovation is often used as a catch-all word to describe the challenges companies must overcome in order to mass-produce a product, like streamlining, shaving costs, managing supply chains, and assembling teams of collaborators. The business side of product development is an art unto itself. But this book, for the most part, will not concern itself with business innovation. Instead, we will investigate the first steps, the embryos, origins, and private visions that give birth to new things. As I spoke with inventors, they told me stories about hunting the original thought as if it were a rare bird flitting through the forest. The process often involves a craftsmanship of the imagination, in which we carry out experiments in our fantasies. When I get an idea, I start at once building it up in my imagination. I change the construction, make improvements, and operate the device in my mind, the visionary inventor Nikola Tesla wrote. He was describing a process of mental iteration that we all possess, but that too few of us have truly learned how to use. Why we need Inventology. This book will focus on what might be called micro-creativity, that is, invention at the level of the individual. I'm not trying to advance what is known as the great man theory, in which lone heroes are given sole credit for a breakthrough. Rather, it is an acknowledgement that you are one person and so am I. While it's interesting to find out which city generates the most patents per capita, Eindhoven in the Netherlands is often at the top of the list. That doesn't give us much insight into what we need to do as individuals to become more imaginative. After all, if you buy a plane ticket to Eindhoven and stroll along its charming canal, you likely won't be struck with genius. It's crucial that we find out what people actually do as they invent things. What are they doing in their minds and with their hands? We need a new field of study. Call it Inventology to answer that question. If you aspire to run a marathon, you can read thousands of books on training for peak performance. You can pore over studies of the benefits of carb loading and wind sprints. But for those who aspire to invent, it's much harder to find this kind of actionable research. And yet, as I dug through historical archives, I encountered a few pioneers who did try to discover a formula for invention. For instance, a Soviet science fiction writer named Genrikh Altschuler pored over thousands of patents in the mid-20th century, mining that trove for clues about the human imagination. He developed methods for predicting future technologies and for solving mechanical riddles. He also founded a school for inventors in Azerbaijan, the likes of which has never existed before or since. Later in this book, we will spend time with Altschuler and some of the other visionaries who tried to launch a new science of invention. We will also meet the modern-day researchers whose work can help us understand the inventive mind. They're economists, psychologists, inventors, neuroscientists, engineers, crowdfunders, and ethnographers. Because these investigators are isolated from each other in different fields, the puzzle pieces of inventology are widely scattered. This book will put those pieces together. It is based on more than 100 interviews with inventors and explorers in many fields, as well as dozens of studies and research papers. I have set out to answer 4 questions. 1. Who really invents? 2. How do they do it? 3. What can the rest of us learn from the data on successful invention? 4. How will 21st century invention be transformed by crowdfunding, 3D printing, big data, and other new technologies? A bit more about that final question. We are at a moment in history when the barriers to invention are falling as never before. On your laptop, you can draw upon R&D tools far beyond anything that a Bell Labs engineer would have had in his workshop in the 1960s. You can raise money from a bunch of strangers and then ask them to give you feedback. You can exchange digital files that encode the shape of an eyeglass lens or the curve of a bike frame. You can communicate directly with factories and operate like a commercial manufacturer. You can use your phone and a credit card to hire lab researchers who will test a drug on a genetically engineered mouse according to your directions. You can consult a worldwide library of millions of research papers and exchange ideas with zillions of potential collaborators. Many of the people I interviewed for this book alerted me to how profoundly their lives had changed because of these new tools. Their personal experiences speak to the revolutionary shift now taking place. In the 1870s, Thomas Edison built an idea factory where he corralled engineers, mechanics, and chemists and leaned over their shoulders. That centralized invention-in-one-place method caught fire in the 20th century. But now it seems to be going the way of the incandescent light bulb. Already, many of us are becoming, at least in some small degree, inventors. We can act as small-time funders of products. We can tell corporations about what we want and even collaborate with them on design, entering into a two-way communication about the things that we use. If we hate a product, we can collectively kill it on a site like Amazon, where we band together with other people who point out its shoddy design. And we can form communities to invent everything from sports equipment to body parts. The tools are changing, and so too is the kind of imagination that we will need to master the new opportunities around us. Ideas are no longer just hovering in the air. They're also zipping through fiber optic cable. For this reason, I will focus on inventions and discoveries of the past 50 years, rather than those from earlier eras. Five paths. We tend to believe that great ideas arrive like angels, in a flash of light. This assumption has been handed down to us from the ancient Greeks, who regarded creativity as a gift from the muses. As the ancients saw it, people don't invent so much as wait for a deity to deliver an illumination. In the Middle Ages, the word inspiration meant that God had breathed the truth straight into a person's mind. Even today, we talk of problem solving as a passive process of gobsmacking. And we treasure stories about revelations that came easily and took only a moment. One of those fables concerns Auguste Kekule, the chemist who dreamed about a snake eating its own tail and woke up to discover the ring-shaped structure of the benzene molecule. But that story, so often repeated as fact, was popularized by a humorous article written in the 19th century, and Kekule's famous dream was likely the punchline to a joke about scientific posturing. Still, even when we know these stories are false, they enchant us. Perhaps that's because the true narratives of invention are nuanced and labyrinthine, and they don't lend themselves to fairy tales. The wizards I interviewed, like Bill English, who worked with Doug Engelbart on the first computer mouse, were eager to instruct me about just how much time it takes to crack a difficult problem. You have to observe, imagine, fantasize, forage, and experiment just to cobble together the idea, never mind the prototype. They described several different paths toward the breakthrough, some of which had never occurred to me. For instance, an engineer named Martin Cooper, inventor of the handheld cell phone, told me that his first inklings began in the 1960s with a vision of a science fiction future. Cooper imagined that one day everyone would be issued a phone number at birth and walk around with communicators in their pockets. In the 1970s, as smaller batteries and transistors became available, Cooper and his colleagues at Motorola did manage to cobble together a handheld cell phone. Primitive though it was, the prototype opened up a new set of possibilities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.